الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد وإني مدخل إلى علم الفقه Introduction to fiqh. وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدُ وَالْمِنَّةِ We've spoken previously in our last lesson about Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. We didn't just talk about the Imam, but we talked about the Madhab as well. And the most important books within the Madhab. And we spoke about the students of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa and the stages in which the Madhab went through. Today, inshaAllah ta'ala, we're going to be speaking about the second followed madhab. Madhab al-Imam Malik rahimahullah. We're going to be talking about al-Imam Malik himself. We're going to give a short summarized biography of the Imam. And we're also going to speak about the madhab. Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik ibn Abi Amir al-Asbahi al-Himyari al-Madani. So his kunya is Abu Abdullah. His name is Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik. So he's Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik ibn Abi Amir al-Asbahi al-Himyari al-Madani. Then Al-Imam Malik is an Arab. Al-Imam Malik was an Arab, he wasn't a foreigner. Al-Imam Malik was a... He was an Arab. And he was not mawla... He wasn't a mawlan, he wasn't a slave, or he didn't go through slavery, none of his family members went through slavery. Rahimahullah. And ذلك Al-Imam Al-Zuhri used to say mawlahum, mawla, and he would use that term. And he used to kind of annoy Al-Imam Malik. And he would say, لَيْتَهُ لَمْ يَرْوِي عَنَّا I wish he didn't narrate from us. Referring to who? His teacher, Muhammad ibn Shahab al-Zuhri. على كل حال, Al-Imam Malik is Himyari. He's a tribe well known as Himyari. And he's Madani, meaning he was a resident in where? In Al-Madina. There are three views in regards to his birth. There are three views in regards to his birth. When was he born? The first one is that he was born 93. They said he was born 93. The second view is 94. And the second view is 97. So it's 93, 94 and 97. Those are the three views that Al-Imam Malik, his birth. I mentioned this before, one of the amazement or the shocking things about the biography of Imam Malik is his mother was pregnant 4 years. She was carrying him for 4 years. This is what the mu'arrikhun, the historians mention. Was in the stomach of his mother for how long? Ibn Abdul Barr mentions that as well. Ghareeb. Na'am. Al-Imam Malik was an imam in three things. He was an imam. إمام في السنة. He was an imam in the sunnah. إمام في الحديث. And he was an imam in hadith. And he was an imam في الفقه. He was an imam in all three. And we will mention examples of that, inshaAllah ta'ala. The scholars all agreed that he is an imam in all three. There's no khilaf. Are we all together, brothers? Al-Imam Malik. إمامته في السنة there's no dispute about it. That is an imam من أئمة السنة. Okay? And that is different from إمام في الحديث. لأن السنة represents معتقد, belief. لكن إمام في الحديث means he knows and he mastered the science of hadith. Imam Malik was an imam in that as well. And he was also إمام في الفقه. No one disputed that Imam Malik is fiqh. No one said he's not a faqih. Are we all together? وَلِذَلِكَ three of the four were unanimously agreed upon. Are you with me, brothers? Al-Imam Abu Hanifa's imam in fiqh was agreed upon. So was Al-Imam Malik and Imam Al-Shafi. As for Ahmed, some people disagreed whether they should add him to the what? Na'am, and say give him a madhab. From them is Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. He didn't give Imam Malik that status. And walidalik, because of that, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari in Iraq was given a hard time. The Hanabila, they hurt him, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, and they caused him a lot of harm. Are we all together, brothers? Ala kulli hal, Malik is from the imams whose madhab is what? Sorry, his fiqh is agreed upon. And so was al-imamu. And so was his imama in hadith and his imama in sunnah. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ al-imam Malik, if he differs with his khilaf is mu'tabar. This is very important that you understand this, brothers. Like al-imam Malik, if he says something which is outside, you can't say that the scholars have ijma' in this issue. He's from the people who can break that ijma'. If that ijma' was not before him. If that ijma' was not before him. Are we all together, brothers? وَلِذَلِكَ a lot do you read in scholars saying, خِلَافُهُ مُعْتَبَرُ. This man's khilaf is given precedence. Whereas today, if I said, nah, I differ with the scholars in this issue, who are you? Nah. The question is, who are you, AbdulRahman? So my khilaf is not mu'tabar. Are we all together, brothers? Like in the khilaf of these imams is mu'tabar. Always given weight. And Imam Malik is from them. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. Al-Imam Malik, he inherited the knowledge from the scholars of Medina, the fuqaha of Medina. And Medina had seven jurists. Seven jurists. They were referred to as fuqaha al-sab'ah. And a scholar compiled, he gathered them in a couple of lines of poetry. He said, إِذَا قِيلَ مَنْ فِي الْعِلْمِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ رِوَايَتُهُمْ لَيْسَتْ عَنِ الْعِلْمِ خَارِجَةً فَقُلْهُمْ عُبَيْدُ اللَّهِ عُرْوَةٌ قَاسِمٌ سَعِيدٌ أَبِي بَكْرٍ سُلَيْمَانُ خَارِجَةً These are called what? فُقَهَا السَّبْعَةَ The seven فُقَهَا, the seven jurists. And they were the seven jurists of where? Medina. So Medina had fiqh. Medina, what did he have? Fiqh, of course he had fiqh. Rather, Medina was where the Prophet died, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's where the Prophet ﷺ, when he left this world, that was the last place he was at. Are we all together, brothers? And this kind of pushed Al-Imam Malik to believe that the view of the people of Medina should be given more precedence than the view of any other land. Because they were the last people who saw the Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he took knowledge from them, rahimahullahu ta'ala. And when Al-Imam Malik died, the scholars, they cried for his death. For example, Hammad ibn Zaydin was told about the death of Al-Imam Malik. This is how high he was, how great he was. He was informed of the death of Al-Imam Malik. And then he started to cry. Hammad ibn Zayd is a great imam. Tears just started to roll from his eyes onto his cheeks. And then he said, يَرْحَمُ اللَّهُ أَبَا عَبْدِ اللَّهِ May Allah have mercy upon Al-Imam Malik. لَقَدْ كَانَ مِنَ الدِّينِ بِمَكَانِ This man, he had a big place in the religion. Al-Imam Malik had a what? A big place in the religion. Al-Imam Shafi'i said about him, إِذَا ذُكِرَ الْعُلَمَى When the scholars are mentioned, فَمَالِكُنِ النَّجْمِ فَمَالِكُنِ النَّجْمِ If the scholars is mentioned, Al-Imam Malik is the star. He's the star of all of them. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i said about Al-Imam Malik, إِذَا ذُكِرَ الْعُلَمَى فَمَالِكُنِ النَّجْمِ Al-Imam Malik is the star for them. The highest of them. Also, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, مَا أَحَدٌ أَمَنَّ عَلَيَّ Shafi'i said, there is nobody who has favored me, who has bestowed blessing onto me, who has favors on me. Min Malik ibn Anas, then al-Imam Malik. Who said this? Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. He said, ma ahadun amanna alayya. There is nobody who has greater favor on me. Min Malik ibn Anas, then al-Imam Malik. He also used to say, al-Imam al-Shafi'i used to say, Malik ibn Anas, mu'allimi. Al-Imam Malik is my teacher. وَعَنْهُ أَخَذْتُ الْعِلْمِ. And from him I took knowledge. Are you with me, brothers? And from him I took knowledge. And this is very important, brothers, that you know, you understand the person you once upon a time took knowledge from and give them that status. وَلِذَلِكَ. This is what you tend to find in the biography of the scholars, that they always honor their teacher. They always respect their teacher. Al-Imam Malik, he did refute Al-Imam Malik. Shafi'i did refute Imam Malik on some issues that he differed with him on. But he never ever put him down. He honored him. He said, he's my teacher. He said, he has favors on me. Are you with me, brothers? But he stuck to the point that he differed with him on. AbdulRahman ibn Mahdi said, A'immatu an-nas, the imams, the leaders of the people, fi zamanihim, at their time, arba'a is four. Sufyan al-Thawri bil Kufa. Sufyan al-Thawri in Kufa. Wa Malikum bil Hijaz. And al-Imam Malik in where? Hijaz. Hijaz is Makkah and Medina. Wal Awza'i bil Sham. And al-Imam al-Awza'i where? In Sham. Wa Hamad ibn Zaydin bil Basra. And Hamad ibn Zaydin where? Basra. So we have Sufyan al-Thawri in Kufa. He's the Imam of the people of Kufa. And Al-Imam Al-Awza'i, who's Imamu? Al-Imam Ahli Sham. Al-Imam Malik, who's what? He's the people of Hijaz. And Hamad ibn Zayd is what? He's the Imam of what? The people of Basra. Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi, he said, Ma ra'aytu, I never saw a'qala min Malik ibn Anas. Anyone more smarter than Al-Imam Malik? I never saw. Smart man, very clever. قيل للإمام أحمد بن حنبل. Somebody came to Imam Ahmed and they said, Imam Ahmed, يا أبا عبد الله رجل يريد أن يحفظ حديث رجل. There's someone here who wants to memorize one particular scholar, all of his narrations. He wants to memorize the hadith of one particular imam. رجل واحد بعينه بحديث من ترى له. Who do you think he should memorize his hadith? He then said, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed said, يحفظ حديث مالك. Let him memorize حديث مالك. Are you with me, brothers? Tell him to memorize all the hadith of Imam Malik. That's enough. Are you with me, brothers? ولذلك Imam Malik's narrations, I mean, he's considered to be from the what? From the golden chain. Have you ever heard of the golden chain? Have you? Iraqi says in his Alfiya, إِمْسَاكُنَا عَنْ حُكْمِنَا عَلَى سَنَدْ بِأَنَّهُ أَصَحُ مُطْلَقًا وَقَدْ خَابَ بِهِ قَوْمٌ فَقِيلَ مَالِكٌ عَنْ نَافِعٍ بِمَا رَوَاهُ عَنْهُ نَاسِكُ. Al-Imam Malik عن نافع عن ابن عمر. Malik, نافع عن ابن عمر. It's the golden chain. What is it called? And if it goes like this, it's even better. Ahmed, Shafi'i, Malik, Nafi' and Ibn Umar. Golden chain. This is his position at Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. So Ahmed said to the man, memorize the hadith of Imam Malik. Imam al-Dhahabi, what did he say about Imam Malik? He said, huwa shaykhul Islam. Hujjatul Ummah. He's the proof of this Ummah. Imam Udari Hijra. He is the Imam of Medina. Something shocking. Dahabi said, وَطَالَبَ مَالِكٌ. Al-Imam Malik sought al-ilm. He sought knowledge. وَهُوَ ابْنُ بِضْعَ عَشَرَ سَنَةً. He was 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Let's say from 13 onwards, he started to seek real knowledge. What are our 13-year-olds doing? Playing what? Fortnite. They're watching movies. They're watching cartoons. They're watching comics. Superman, Spider-Man, that's what they're watching. 13, and Imam Malik was going out there to seek real knowledge. Ilm. Look at this. وَتَأَهَّلَ لِلْفُتْيَا. He became committed to give fatwa. وَجَلَسَ لِلْإِفَادَةِ. And he sat down to teach. وَلَهُ إِحْدَى وَعِشْرِينَ سَنَةً. He was 21 years of age. When he was 21, he had a seat in the Prophet's masjid to teach. Now, I want you to think about this, brothers. 21 at that time was the time of real knowledge. Are you with me, brothers? Ulama, Jahabida were alive at that time. He's 21 years of age. Did he just take that chair and sit on it? Look what he said. Al-Imam Malik, he said this about himself. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. Oh, we're going to mention it later. Or let's say it now. He said, "Ma jalastu, I never sat down, illa ba'da an shahida li sab'una, until 70 scholars said to me, in Medina, go teach. Don't sit down. You have the rights to teach. At what age? 70 fuqaha, ulama of Medina, they all said to him, go. You are the one. You are the one, Malik. Go and teach and benefit the people. How old is he? He's 21. He took a seat in the Prophet's masjid to teach the people. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. And you have to understand, he wasn't just teaching, he was allowed to give fatwa. The teaching, a person can prepare the lesson and come. Lakin fatwa is meaning you can do ijtihad. He's allowed to give verdict from the Quran and the Sunnah. At what age? 21. Rahimahullah. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi said, وَحَدَّثَ عَنْهُ جَمَاعَةٌ. Many people narrated from Al-Imam Malik. وَهُوَ حَيٌّ شَابٌ طَرِيٌّ وَقَصَدَهُ الطَّلَبَةُ الْعِلْمِ مِنَ الْآفَاقِ فِي آخِرِ دَوْلَةِ أَبِي جَعْفَرِ الْمَنْصُورِ وَمَا بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ وَازْدَحَمُوهُ عَلَيْهِ فِي خِلَافَةِ الرَّشِيدِ وَإِلَىٰ أَنْ مَاتَ. Al-Imam Malik became تُضْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ أَكْبَادُ الْإِبِلِ. People were coming from all over the world to see him. People were coming from the whole entire globe. يَأْتُونَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. Everyone was coming from every corner to meet Al-Imam Malik and to narrate from him. لِمَكَانَتِهِ وَعِلْمِهِ, because of his knowledge and because of his status. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ. And he was a young boy. And he carried on from 21 until the ending of his life, until he died, rahimahullahu ta'ala, until the khilafah of Harun al-Rashid, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Here there's a point I want to mention, which is the concept of tazkiyah. And Imam Malik, what did he say? مَا حَدَّثْتُ, I didn't narrate, nor did I talk, حَتَّى شَهِدَ لِي سَبْعُونَ, until 70 scholars gave me. So you got a tazkiyah, right? The scholars, they divide the tazkiyah into two. This is very important that we take this into consideration. The scholars, they divide and they break the tazkiyah. The tazkiyah means you've been praised. The tazkiyah, the scholars, they divided into two. Tazkiyah to a'yan wa tazkiyah to al-ilm. Tazkiyah to al-a'yan means a scholar specifically praises you. And he says, so and so, he's entitled to teach. I believe he is a rightful candidate to be the imam or to do this or to give fatwa or whatever. A scholar gives you this. Or the scholar says to the people, take knowledge from this person. This is tazkiyatul a'yan. Individually, you've been given a praise. This is the highest and the best. And this is a high level. But there's another type, which is tazkiyatul ilm. What is it called? Tazkiyatul ilm. And tazkiyatul ilm means what? No particular person praised you. No particular scholar praised you. You haven't got praise from a particular scholar. But what you do have, knowledge that praises you. What do you have? You have knowledge that praises you. Meaning, your knowledge is in line with the Qur'an and the Sunnah. وَبِمَا عَلَيْهِ سَلَفُ الصَّالِحِ And that which the pious predecessors are upon. And what you're saying does not leave what the scholars of that time are saying. So we look at your statement, and your statement is in line with what the scholars are saying. It's in line with what the pious predecessors were upon. This is also a tazkiyah. This is also a tazkiyah. And this is the most important one. Because a scholar can praise you and you can change. Are you with me? Person can change. AbdulRahman ibn Muljim, who killed Ali ibn Abi Talib, Uthman praised him at the beginning of the early stages. And Uthman ibn Affan, or Umar ibn Khattab, one of the two, appointed him to teach the Quran in Kufa or Iraq. He was praised at the beginning, no problem. And who did he kill at the end? He called Ali ibn Abi Talib. He was the one who murdered Abdullah and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Wasil ibn Ata, the leader of the Mu'tazila, him and Amr ibn Ubaid. Wasil ibn Ata, who was his student for? Who did he take knowledge from? Hassan al-Basri. Hassan al-Basri took knowledge from. Are you with me, brothers? So what is more important to everybody else is not a paper that you got from somewhere or a qualification that you necessarily have or an institution that you graduated from. This is a paper. What really matters is that your knowledge, your deen, and you are in line with the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and you're in line with the statement of the pious predecessors. That's what matters. Are you with me, brothers? That's why we say to Allah, رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِقْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَّابُ. Oh Allah, don't turn us on our heels once you've guided us to the straight path. الْقُلُوبُ بَيْنَ أُصْبُعَيْنِ مِنْ أَصَابِعِ الرَّحْمَنِ يُقَلِّبُهَا كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. The hearts are between the fingers of Allah. Allah tosses and turns it the way He wishes. Are you with me? يصبح الرجل مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا ويمسي مؤمنا ويصبح كافرا يبيع دينه بعرض من الدنيا. The Prophet said that. A person is a believer in the morning and in the evening he is a disbeliever. And in the evening he is a believer and in the morning he is a believer. Are we all together, brothers? Changing. Buying his whole deen for a portion of the dunya. Are we all together, brothers? So what really matters, brothers, is two things. A person, what praises him is his ilm. And when we say ilm, according to the salaf, the term ilm, it wasn't information you gathered. It was also your actions. You have to remember that all the time. Ilm, in the salaf, according to the salaf, it meant al-amal, action. They never considered a person to have knowledge if he never implemented what he knew. Are you with me, brothers? If you just know but you don't implement it, what is said about you is you have information, Allahu Akbar. You've gathered information, but you're not a person of knowledge. Person of knowledge is the one who what? Who came to know something and implemented it. That is an alim, a scholar. Al-Imam Malik was also, as I mentioned, he was sahib al-sunnah, al-imam upon the sunnah, al-imam Malik. And his aqidah was profound and great. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. He used to say, لَيْسَ الْجِدَالُ فِي الدِّينِ بِشَيْءٍ. Argumentation has nothing to do with religion. Imam Malik used to hate arguing. ولذلك, a man came to Imam Malik and he said, I want to argue with you, I want to debate with you. Imam Malik said to him, if I beat you and I win, will you follow me? He said, yes. He said, what about if you win and you beat me? And he said, you should follow me. He said, what about if a third person comes and they beat both of us. Should we follow that person? And then he said, yes. And Imam Malik said, it seems like you are not consistent upon what you believe. You're jumping from one place to another. As for me, إِنِّي عَلَى بَيِّنَةٍ مِّنْ أَمْرِي وَأَنْتَ شَاكٍ فَذْهَبْ إِلَى شَاكٍ مِثْلِكَ فَخَاصِمْهُ. I'm upon certainty of my religion. I'm not bouncing because somebody more argumentative than I am has come and beat me in a debate. Doesn't necessarily make me change my position. So it seems like you're in a doubtful state. Go to somebody like you who's doubtful and debate with them. He never liked debating. It wasn't because he didn't have the knowledge to debate. La ilaha illallah, he did. Are you with me, brothers? But it's because he understood, rahimahullah, that debates, it doesn't bring about a lot. It doesn't. He also used to say, Ahlul Ahwa, the people of desires, بئس القوم, evil are they. The people of desires, evil are they. لا يسلم عليهم, don't give them greetings. وَاعْتِزَالُهُمْ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ, and to boycott them is more beloved to me than anything else. The people of desires, he said, rahimahullah, Imam Malik, evil are they. Evil people are they. And they are a people, one should not greet them. لا يسلم عليهم. وَاعْتِزَالُهُمْ, and to boycott them and stay away from them, أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ, is more beloved to me. Is more beloved to me. And Imam Malik used to say, Al-Imanu qawlun wa amal, that Iman is speech and actions. Because there were other groups that didn't say that, like the Murji'ah and the Khawarij and etc. He also used to say, Al-Qur'anu kalamullah, the Qur'an is the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla. He also used to say, Man qala al-Qur'an, anyone who says that the Qur'an is makhluq, yuja'u darban, he should be beaten. Wa yuhbasu hatta yatub, and he should be imprisoned until he repents from what he said. So Imam Malik was like that when it came to his aqidah and his belief. He didn't like the deen to be tainted, nor did he like the religion to be played with and to be altered and anything to be added to it, rahimahullah ta'ala. One of the things that he used to say was, لا ينبغي, it is not permissible. الإقامة في أرض, in a land, يكون العمل فيها بغير الحق. You should not stay in a land where the truth cannot be established. You cannot do your religion. والسب للسلف, and the salaf are being insulted and they're being called names. You shouldn't stay in that land. Al-Imam Malik is talking about a land where innovators control it. That's what he's talking about. Imagine if it was the land of the disbelievers. Qadiyya akhar. It's a whole different dialogue, whole different discussion now. He's talking about a land where Muslims run it, but they don't let you practice your religion. He said, you shouldn't stay in that land. Leave it. Do hijrah from it. And a place where the salaf, the sahabas, are being cursed. He said, no one should stay in that land. Are we all together, brothers? A person should have stayed there. Ja'far ibn Abdullah, he said, كنا عند مالك, we were with Imam Malik, فجاءه رجل, a man came. فقال, he said, يا أبا عبد الله, he said to Imam Malik, الرحمن على العرش استوى, كيف استوى? A man said to Imam Malik, how did Allah go above his throne? Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he looked at the earth, وجعل ينكت بعود في يده, he had a twig in his hand. So he started to scribble on the earth. He was writing. Some of the narrations mention he started to sweat from his forehead. And then he looked at the man. He raised his head and he looked at him after a while of thinking. And then he said to him, Al-kayfu minhu ghayru ma'qul. The how, it's not one that can be perceived. Are we all together, brothers? Meaning it's not something we know. Are we all together, brothers? Pay attention. Did Al-Imam Malik deny the kayfiyah? Did he negate it? No, he didn't negate it. He just said, we don't know it. It's just something we haven't perceived. There's a difference between what Malik is saying here. Malik is not rejecting that there is a kayfiyah, but we don't know it. We don't know that. He said, this is something our minds can comprehend. وَالِاسْتِوَاءُ, as for the word istiwa, he said, غَيْرُ مَجْهُولٍ, it's not something that's unknown to us. We know what it means. The Salaf, what did they call istiwa? عَلَى وَارْتَفَعْ. It's not something that's unknown to us. We know what istiwa means. وَالْإِيمَانُ بِهِ وَاجِبٌ, to believe in it is what? Obligatory. You have to believe in it. وَالسُّؤَالُ عَنْهُ بِدْعَةٌ, asking me this question, which is how did Allah go above His throne, is an innovation. وَأَظُنُّكَ, and I believe you are صَاحِبُ بِدْعَةٌ, you're an innovator. I believe you're an innovator. وَأُمِّرَ بِهِ فَأُخْرِجَ, he said, take him out of the mystery. Take this man out of the mystery. They grabbed him by the collar and they threw him out of the mystery. Why did Imam Malik do that? Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen said, he was implementing the ayah and he falls under the ayah, فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ مَنَعَ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ أَنْ يُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ. He's a person who's bringing corruption. Are we all together? Into the masjid. So Imam Malik believed to stop this evil before it starts to spread. And he has that authority. He has that what? Power. Everybody in the city of Medina is going to be like, are you the man who Imam Malik threw you out of the masjid? A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. That's what they will say to him. Are we all together, brothers? Also, Imam Malik, what he used to say was, Junnatul Alim. This statement, you need to memorize it. He used to say, Junnatul Alim. The shield of the scholar is, La Adri, I don't know. I don't know is the shield of the scholar. إِذَا أَغْفَلَهَا, if the scholar misses it, or he becomes heedless, he doesn't use it, أُصِيبَتْ مَقَاتِلُهُ, the arrow that was thrown at him is going to hit him. He's going to die from it. Are we all together, brothers? So لا أدري is what? What is لا أدري? It's a shield for you to go to hide in when you don't know something. وَالْكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَلَاحِ الْأَرْبَعَ يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي فَكُنْ مُتَّبِعًا. All of the scholars, whenever they felt they didn't know the answer to the question, they would say, I don't know. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ مَالِكُ, a man asked him a question. Abdurrahman al-Mahdi, he said, سَأَلَ رَجُلٌ مَالِكًا, a man asked al-Imam Malik a question, عَنْ مَسْأَلَ وَذَكَرَ أَنَّهُمْ أَرْسَلُوهُ, and they said, some people sent me with this question and I cut this distance. 6 months the man was traveling for this question. How long? 6 months. This man was traveling in the desert, in the heat, to come to Imam Malik in Medina to ask him this question. And then he said to him, Imam Malik, when he asked him the question, فَأَخْبِرِ الَّذِي, tell the one, أَرْسَلَكَ, who sent you, أَنِّي لَا أَعْلَمُ, I don't know anything regarding this issue. Go back to those people and inform them, I have no knowledge of these questions that you're asking me. And the man said, وَمَنْ يَعْلَمُهَا, then who knows it? 6 months. Then who knows it? And Imam Malik didn't say, oh, if I don't know, no one else knows it, just go back. He didn't say that. He said, الَّذِي عَلَّمَهُ اللَّهُ, the one who Allah teaches it to him is the one who knows. The one who Allah teaches it to knows it. This shows you that how important it was to them to not speak about a matter which they had no knowledge of. Remember, when you speak, you are signing on behalf of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are you with me, brothers? وَلِذَلِكَ Ibn al-Qayyim, do you know what he called his book, إِعْلَامُ? Why did he call إِعْلَامُ الْمُوَقِعِين? What does مُوَقِعِين mean? What does توقيع mean? Come on, you guys go to the bank, you sign papers, they give it to you, right? What do they say? Sign on the dotted line. Do توقيع here. You are signing on behalf of Allah when you speak. You're giving a fatwa. You're saying, Allah, this is what he said. You're lying about Allah Azza wa Jal. So you need to watch what you're going to say. So Imam Malik used to say, La adri, I don't know. One time he was given so many questions, all of them he said, La adri, next question. La adri, next question. La adri, next question. La adri, next question. 40-something question was asked. And one of them he answered. And the rest he said, La adri, I don't know. This shows their wara and how they wanted to stay away from speaking without no knowledge. Abdullah ibn Wahbin, one of the students of Imam Malik, he said, I can write volumes on the times that Imam Malik said, La adri. Are you with me, brothers? Walidalika Subki wrote a book called La adri. One thick book. One volume. It's actually a prison. The scholars, when they said La adri, Shafi'i and others, when they said it. Another powerful statement that Imam Malik said, he said, Rahimahullahu ta'ala, he said, Ma ta'allamtu, I didn't study. I didn't gain knowledge illa li nafsi. Ma ta'allamtu al-ilma. I didn't learn knowledge illa li nafsi, except for myself. Wa ma ta'allamtuhu liyahtaja an-nasu ilayya. And I never learned knowledge so the people can need me. I didn't learn knowledge so I can be an imam. I never learned knowledge so I can be... No, I learned it for myself. Nafsi. Myself. Me first. And that's very important, brothers. When you read a book, when you go to a lecture, when you are you sitting there to find something that's going to move you to closer to Allah and distance you from the hellfire, or are you sitting there to get this issue against somebody else and prove somebody else wrong? We're all together, brothers. This is the imam. And many other imams were like that. One of the statements Al-Imam Malik said, he said, إِنَّ هَذَا الْعِلْمَ دِينَ. This religion, this knowledge that you're learning is your religion. فَانْظُرُوا عَمَّنْ تَأْخُذُونَ دِينَكُمْ. Look at who you take your religion from. Look at who you take your religion from. If somebody was to tell you today that the doctor that you go to, he really hasn't attained his qualification, he's a fraudster, you would be happy to the person who tells you and you'll stay away from that doctor, true or false? Then why your religion, which is connected to it, your success of this world and the hereafter? Then look at who you take your religion from. Look at them from what angle? Look at his knowledge and look at his wara, his religion. He's eating haram. Are you with me, brothers? And the way he carries himself is nothing in line with the Prophet ﷺ and his way. Then ibta'id anhu. Go far from him. And distance yourself from him. Because this is your religion. This is your deen. Don't gamble with your religion. Al-Imam Malik, he died when the year was 179, he died. And there is no dispute when he died. And this is very common. It tells you that when he was born, okay, nobody knew. Because remember, he hasn't achieved anything. But now he's Imam al-Dunya. So it is what? It is documented. وَلِذَٰلِكَ الْإِمَامُ الذَّهَبِيُّ He said, رَحِمَهُ تَعَالَى, about the scholars of hadith. You know, scholars of hadith always write the deaths of everybody because they want to keep it documented. So he saw people who were waiting to write. They wrote his name and they left a blank space to write when he dies. His own students. They have to write it down. And he said, أُرِيدُ حَيَاتِي وَيُرِيدُ مَوْتِي. I want them to live because I'm giving them the hadith of the Prophet and I'm educated and they're waiting for the day I'm dying and they want my death. My death. Because the scholars of hadith, that's how they are. Now we're going to go to an Imam Malik students. We have an understanding of who this Imam is. We're going to go into his students. His students, we said they are these five. Abdullah ibn Wahbin, AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim, Ashhab ibn Abdul Aziz, Abdullah ibn Abdul Hakam, and Ma'ar ibn Isa. These are the five students of Al-Imam Malik rahimahullah. They are his prominent students rahimahullah. Abdullah ibn Wahbin, he died the year 197. When did he die? Abdullah ibn Wahbin, he died 197. Abdurrahman ibn al-Qasim, he died 191. Ashhab ibn Abdul Aziz died 204. 204. Abdullah ibn Abdul Hakam. He died 214. Ma'an ibn Isa, he died 198. These are his students. The one who stuck with Al-Imam Malik the most from those five is Ma'an ibn Isa. He's min al-mulazimin al-Imam Malik. He stuck close to Al-Imam Malik. And the way he stuck with Al-Imam Malik was mulazama tamma. He became like the shadow of Al-Imam Malik rahimahullah. Until they used to say, إِنَّهُ كَانَ يَتَوَسَّدُ عَتَبَةَ الْبَابِ. He used to sleep on the front porch of the door of the house. And if Al-Imam Malik came out, he would get up and he would go and he would narrate from him. It was said that Ma'ar ibn Isa was used to be called Usayyata, Usayyata Malik. What does Usayyata Malik mean? The stick of Al-Imam Malik. Usayyata is Tasgir, is Asa Malik, the small stick of Al-Imam Malik. He would stick with him everywhere he went. And he would write everything from him. Now we're going to go into the third part, inshallah ta'ala, which is بعض الملامح في المذهب. We're going to speak about the madhab, the categorization that it has. And we categorize the madhab into four. The first one is ما كتبه الإمام مالك بنفسه, that which Al-Imam Malik himself wrote. What did Al-Imam Malik write? He wrote his muwatta, right? Are you with me, brothers? What did Al-Imam Malik write? He wrote his muwatta. His muwatta is called, it's referred to as fiqh athari. It's fiqh athar. Fiqh athar is different. What does it mean? It's ahadith al-ahkam. Ahadith which have in it what? Jurisprudent rulings. So the Maliki madhab, the beauty about it is the fact that it started with what? The whole madhab, it started with the ahadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Are you with me, brothers? So this is where it comes from. And in the Al-Imam Malik, what does he have? Al-Imam Malik has his statements and his views are in there, in his muwatta. We mentioned the best sharah for his muwatta is what? Two books. Because in the muwatta, there are what? Marfu'at. There's mawqufat as well. There's marfu'at and other than marfu'at. Are you with me, brothers? Marfu'at means that which is attributed to the Prophet. The book that explains what is attributed to the Prophet is At-Tamhid ibn Abdul Barr. At-Tamhid by who? Ibn Abdul Barr. And the best tahqiq for that, we said that it's the Bashar Awad Ma'roof. His tahqiq is the best so far. Even he's under a lot of heat by other muhaqqiqin. They're criticizing his efforts and his work on it. But even then, he's the best so far. Bashar Awad Ma'roof's one. We spoke about this when we were talking about Tariq al-Tadwini, al-Sunnah, right? And the second book is the Istithkar by Ibn Abdul Barr as well. The Istithkar, what it does is, it explains the mawqufat, the statements of the companions, that in the Tamhid is marfu'at, meaning the Prophet statements that are in the muwatta, and the Istithkar is anything that is not marfu', meaning that's not attributed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Also, there's another kitab called Al-Qabas by Abu Bakr ibn Arabi al-Maliki rahimahullah. Al-Qabas, which is a sharh of Muwatta al-Imam Malik. It's very good. It is what? It's very good. So the first book is Muwatta al-Imam Malik. The second book is Al-Asmi'ah. ما سمعه تلاميذه, that which his students heard from him. What are they called? Al-Asmi'ah. It's referred to as what? Al-Asmi'ah. And when we spoke about the Al-Asmi'ah, there are two people who had the most, who heard the most from Al-Imam Malik. They had the most from the five students. And those two are who? AbdulRahman ibn Qasim al-Misri. AbdulRahman ibn Qasim al-Misri, he narrated so much, they said it reached 300 what? 300 volumes. And ibn al-Qasim kana indahu. Ibn al-Qasim, AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim, it was with him min al-asmi'ati an al-imam Malikin ma yaqrubu min 300 jalad. Ama 300 mujallad. 300 volumes if it was published. That he heard from who? Al-Imam Malik. The second person who heard a lot from Al-Imam Malik is who? Ma'an ibn Isa al-Madani. Ma'an ibn Isa al-Madani, what did he hear from Al-Imam Malik? A lot. Because remember, I told you he was what? Min al-mulazimina lil-Imam Malik, mulazamatan tamma. He stuck with Al-Imam Malik so much. Hatta kana yatawassadu atamat al-bab. He used to cover his face from the dust and sleep in the porch of Imam Malik's house. And whenever he came out, he would write from him. So these two, Ma'ad ibn Isa al-Madani and AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim al-Misri, both of these were the most, when it came to this, ما سمعه تلاميذ, that which his students heard from him. And this is called al-Asmi'ah. Asmi'ah takes a second level. Okay, this is the order. Here is al-mustakhrajat. What does al-mustakhrajat mean? Al-mustakhrajat is ma kharrajahu talamidhu al-imam. It is what the students of the imam extract from what? Min fatawihi, from his verdicts. Al-Imam Malik gave verdicts, right? A question was asked, he gave a fatwa. They take that fatwa and they apply it. An event or a situation that has not been given a verdict by the imam. The imam didn't give a verdict to it. This is called a what? Al-mustakhrajat. In the madhab, this is the third. Last but not least, ijtihadu a'immatil madhab. The scholars within the madhab, they go and they give fatwa. He then summarize it now. Madhab Imam Malik, it stands on these four. Madhab Imam Malik stands on what? These four. The first one is ma katabahu al-imamu, that which the imam himself wrote. And this is the muwatta. The second one is al-asmi'ah. And al-asmi'ah means what the students heard from Imam Malik. And we said the students here, the two who heard the most from Imam Malik is AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim and Ma'an ibn Isa. The third one is al-mustakhrajat. And al-mustakhrajat, we said, is what the students take from the fatwa of the imam for an event that had not taken place, or a verdict was not given by the imam in that particular event. So they use it, take a fatwa in a particular event the imam gave it to, and they use it for an event that he didn't give it to. The fourth one is ijtihadu a'immatil madhab. The ijtihad, the independent reasoning that the imams of the madhab did. So four of those stages. Ma katabu al-imamu, that which the imam himself wrote, al-asmi'ah, al-mustakhrajat, and al-ijtihadat. Those are the four. And the madhab of Imam Malik, this is where the juice came from. Are you with me, brothers? Now we're going to go into ahamul mu'allafati fil madhab. We're going to speak about the prominent books that are written in the madhab. The first one is the Muwatta of Al-Imam Malik. The second one is the Al-Mudawwana. Al-Mudawwana is written by Sahnoon. Who's written by? Sahnoon wrote it. He authored it. Who died in 240, Sahnoon. And the Kitab Sahnoon is actually questions from Asad ibn al-Furat to who? To AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim. The Mudawwana by Sahnoon is built upon what? As'ila, questions by Asad ibn al-Furat to AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim al-Misri. That's the second book. The Al-Mustakhraja, which is also known as Atabiyyah, is written by Muhammad ibn Ahmad Al-Utbi. Utbiyyah. The Al-Mustakhraja is also known as what? Al-Utbiyyah. And it's written by Muhammad ibn Ahmad Al-Utbi, who died in 255, and some scholars, they say, no, 254. And we already spoke about it, the Mustakhrajat. And Ibn Rushd, he worked on that book in a kitab which he called it Al-Jam'u wa Tahsil. Al-Jam'u wa Tahsil. Don't confuse the Jam'u wa Tahsil with Ala al-Kaykildi's kitab. Al-Ala al-Kaykildi, rahimahullah, Salahuddin Al-Ala al-Kaykildi, has a kitab called Jam'u wa Tahsil fi Ahkam al-Marasil. That's another kitab. Ibn Rushd has a what? He worked on the kitab written by who? Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Utbi, which is the third one, al-Mustakhraja. The fourth one is al-Wadiha. The fourth one is, it's al-Wadiha, and it's written by Abdul Malik ibn Habib al-Sulami. Abdul Malik ibn Habib al-Sulami. He authored it, and he died the year 238. The last one is Al-Mawaziyyah. The last book is Al-Mawaziyyah, and it's written by Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, who's well known as Al-Mawaz, who died the year 269. And I did tell you at the beginning, these four, Ibn Hajib, he brought it all together in a kitab called Jam'u al-Ummahat. And I then said to you, the Jam'u al-Ummahat by Ibn Hajib, it got explained by Khalil Ibn Ishaq Al-Misri. He explained this book, the Kitab Al-Tawdih by Khalil ibn Ishaq Al-Misri, is a sharah of Jam'u al-Ummahat. He explained it. Who did? Khalil ibn Ishaq Al-Misri. And then what happened was, he felt the need to summarize it in a book which he called it, or it became known as Mukhtasar al-Khalil. Are you with me, brothers? I'm a Matnu Khalil. This kitab, the Mukhtasar of al-Khalil, are you with me, brothers? Is the one that you find is memorized. If you go to Mauritania, they memorize the Mukhtasar al-Khalil. If you go to Morocco, Algeria, countries like that, who follow the Madhab al-Malikiyah, this is the kitab that they... Mukhtasar al-Khalil is their book. Are you with me, brothers? Like, there's an issue with this book. The issue with this book is because, pay attention, where was it taken from? Originally, it came from the Al-Mudawwana, Ahmad al-Utbiyyah, Al-Utbiyyah, Ahmad al-Mustakhraja, whichever you want to call it, Al-Wadiha, and the Mawaziya, which then became Jam'u al-Ummahat. And then it became Al-Tawdih, and Tawdih is a lot of volumes. He summarized the Tawdih So the problem that became was, it became like a riddle. The book became like a lughz, like a riddle. Meaning the words that became so jumbled that you can't understand what he's trying to say here. Are you with me, brothers? Because he's trying to make a small matan out of what? Are you with me, brothers? So it became like a riddle, like it won't even make sense what's being said here. So scholars, what they try to do is faqul ibarat, try to open the terminology. What does he mean here? Try to open it up. And that opening up, sometimes it takes more than 30 pages. Some of the shuruhat. Are you with me, brothers? Just to open a paragraph or a sentence. What's under there? What he's trying to say. وَلِذَلِكَ once upon a time, it used to be the diary of a woman. You have to memorize that book and understand it. And then the father would give you his daughter. Imagine that was the case here. A lot of us will be single, huh? It used to be in Maghrib. Once upon a time in Andalus and these Al-Gharnata and these lands where the Maliki Madhab was strong and everything. And even in Morocco recently. That's what it used to be. The diary of a woman was this kitab. Are you with me, brothers? And it's got thousands of masail fiqhiyah in there. This is the book that Malikiyah, life and death. This is the book for them. Are you with me, brothers? There's another kitab called, that we want to talk about since we're talking about books, is known as Matn al-Risala. It's called Al-Risala by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. It's called what? Al-Risala by who? Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. Many people, they only know the Al-Risala by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani because of Aqidah that they study from it. Are you with me, brothers? Because what the author did was, Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, what he did was, the beginning of the book, before he went to the fiqh, he spoke about what? Aqidah. Because, brothers, when the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man yuridi Allahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fi din," anyone Allah wants good for them, he makes them what? Understand the religion. Here it means what? Aqidah and fiqh. Does that make sense, brothers? So the scholars before, they never used to have this kind of distinguishing one from the other. And so you see a person studying fiqh, but his aqidah is corrupt. Are you with me, brothers? It wasn't happening before. Because a person would study the aqidah and the fiqh together. And it's very important, brothers, that we understand the concept of how important it is that we start with aqidah first before we go into fiqh. The poet, he said, وَبَعْدُ فَالتَّوْحِيدُ عِلْمٌ يَنْبُلُ عَلَى الْعُلُومِ كُلِّهَا وَيَفْضُلُ قَدْ أَوْجَبَ الرَّحْمَنُ مِنْهُ قَدْرًا لَيْسِ يَصِحُ الدِّينَ حَتَّى يُدْرَى. Tawheed, there's a portion you have to know. Okay, aqidah, there's a portion you cannot be ignorant about. You have to know it. So anyways, Al-Risala by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani is also one of the books within their madhab which they truly like. One of another books that they have is called At-Talqeen by Qadi Abdul Wahhab. It's called what? At-Talqeen by who? Qadi Abdul Wahhab. And there's Matn al-Ashir. Al-Andalusi wrote. There are many books within that Maliki madhab. There are a lot of books within the madhab. Now we're going to go into the last portion of our session, which is istilahat al-malikiyah, terminologies which they use. We're going to start with istilahat al-khasah bi kutubihim, terminologies that are specific to their books. For example, they use the word al-kitab. The Maliki will say al-kitab. What do they mean by when they say al-kitab? They mean the al-mudawwana. They mean the al-mudawwana that we mentioned by Sahnoun. Because that book means a lot to them. So when they say al-kitab, they mean the what? Al-mudawwana. What about when they say al-ummahatu arba? The four mothers. The four mothers, they mean the al-mudawwana, the mustakhraja, the alwa al-utbiya. You can call the mustakhraja or al-utbiya the same. And the muwaziya, right? And the wadiha. What about when they say ad-dawaween? The dawaween, when they use that term, they mean seven books. when they use the word الدواوين, الدواوين, they mean seven books. Four of those we just mentioned, المدونة, المستخرجة, الواضحة, الموازية, and then three extra, which is المختلطة by Ibn al-Qasim, المبسوطة by Qadi Ismail, and المجموع by Ubdus. المجموعة by Ibn Ubdus. So when they say الدواوين, they mean how many books? Seven. Four that we just mentioned and three extra. What are the three? المختلطة. المختلطة by who? Ibn Qasim, AbdulRahman Ibn Qasim. And المبسوطة by who? Qadi Ismail. And the مجموع by Ibn Ubdus. We finished the first part of the مصطلحات الخاصة بكتبهم. We're now going to go to terminologies that they use. المصطلحات الخاصة بعلماء وشيوخ المذهب. They use it for the scholars. When they say المدنيون, مدنيون means مدينة. Who do they mean? The مدنيون, the مدنيز. Who do they mean? They are referring to the followers of Al-Imam Malik, such as Ibn Kinana, Ibn Majishun, Mutarrif, Ibn Nafi', Ibn Maslama, and those of that level. وَنُضَرَائِهِمْ. One more time. Some students look frustrated. Ibn Kinana. Ibn Kinana. Ibn Majishun. Ibn Majishun. Mutarrif. Mutarrif. Ibn Nafi'. Ibn Nafi'. Ibn Maslama. And those of that level. What about when they say Al-Masriyun, the Egyptians? Who do they mean? The ones that we mentioned at the top, right? AbdulRahman ibn al-Qasim al-Misri, Ashhab ibn Abdul Aziz al-Misri, Abdullah ibn Wahb al-Misri, and also Asbagh, and Abdullah ibn Hakam al-Misri. So those four I mentioned, and also extra, which is Asbagh. What about when they say Al-Iraqiyun? The Iraqs. Huh? Have you guys heard that? Iraq. The Iraqiyun are the ones in what? Iraq. Who do they mean? They mean Al-Qadi Ismail ibn Ishaq. Al-Qadi Abil Hassan ibn al-Qassar. Ibn Jallab. Al-Qadi Abdul Wahab. Al-Qadi Abil Faraj al-Baghdadi. And al-Shaykh Abi Bakr al-Abhari. وَنُضَرَائِهِمْ, and those of that level. Go to the recording, inshallah ta'ala. What about when they say Al-Maghariba? Those from Maghrib. They refer to al-Shaykh ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, ibn al-Qabisi, ibn al-Labbad, and Abu Bakr Abu al-Walid al-Baji, and also ibn Abdul Barr, okay, and ibn al-Rushd. What about when they say Al-Qarinan? They mean Al-Qarinan. Al-Qarinan, those contemporaries. They are referring to as Ashhab and Ibn Nafi'. Ashhab ibn Abdul Aziz and Ibn Nafi'. What about when they say Al-Akhawain? Al-Akhawan. They are referring to Mutarrif and Ibn al-Majishun. The reason why they call them Al-Akhawan, the two brothers, is because a lot of the times you tend to find Ibn al-Majishun and Mutarrif, they tend to agree with each other a lot. So that's why they call them brothers. What about Al-Qadiyani, the two Qadis? They mean Ibn Qassar and who? Abdul Wahab. وَلِذَلِكَ Malikiya, pay attention to this. The Maliki, the Mutaakhirin of the Malikiya, their view is revolving around a lot of the times with who? Al-Qassar. Are you with me, brothers? And Al-Qadi Abdul Wahab. These are the two. You have to remember that. Al-Qadi Abil Hassan ibn al-Qassar and Al-Qadi Abdul Wahhab. Just like the Shafi'iyya, when we speak about it, we'll see the kalam revolves around who? Al-Imam al-Nawi. And who? And Al-Imam al-Rafi'i. Are you with me, brothers? And who, the Karji, who, if they agreed with each other, okay, good. If they didn't, who should we take? Are you with me, brothers? And ذلك عمدة سالك وعدة الناسك by Ibn al-Naqib al-Masri, by in, it's Al-Imam al-Nawi and Al-Imam al-Rafi'i. And tarjih between the two of them. What about when they say Al-Muhammadani, the two Muhammads? They're referring to Ibn Mawaz and also Ibn Sahnun. Lakin Ibn Arafah, he said, no, it's not those two. It's Ibn Mawaz and it's also Ibn Abdul Hakam. That's what he said. What about when they say Al-Muhammaduna, the Muhammads? Not just two, but a lot of Muhammads. They're referring to four. Who are they? Ibn Abdus, Ibn Suhnun, Ibn Abdul Hakam, and Ibn Mawaz. What about when they say Al-Imam, the Imam? They're referring to as Al-Maziri, Al-Maziriyu. What about when they say Al-Shaykh, the Sheikh? They mean Ibn Abi Zayd Al-Qayrawani. Are you with me, brothers? What about when they say Al-Shaykhani, the two Shaykhani? They mean Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani and also Abu al-Hasan al-Qabisi. We finished the terminologies that they use for their shuyukh and their scholars. We're now going to go into the narrations and the statements. What about when they say al-riwayat, narrations? What do they mean? They mean aqwal al-imam Malik, the statements of al-imam Malik. What about when they say al-aqwal? They mean majority of the times the students of al-imam Malik statements. What about when they say al-ittifaq, agreement? When they say al-ittifaq, it's agreement. What are they referring to? They're referring to the agreement of ahlul madhab, the madhab themselves, not outside the madhab. What about when they say al-ijma'? When the Malikiyya say ijma', what do they mean by that? They mean ijma' of the ulama, generally speaking. What about when they say al-jumhur, the majority? When they say the jumhur, they mean the four imam, the four madhabs believe in this. They believe the four imams. Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Shafi'i and Ahmad. What about when they say al-mutaqaddimin al-mutaakhirin? When they say mutaqaddimin, they mean before Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. And then when they say mutaakhirin, they mean after Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, him included. Does that make sense? So when they say mutaqaddimin al-mutaakhirin, the early and the late, the mutaqaddimin to them is what? Those that came before Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. And the mutaakhirin is what? Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, him and those who came after him. لذلك they call Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani khatimatul mutaqaddimin, the seal and the last of the early generation, and awwalul mutaakhirin, and the beginning of the late generation. So they include him in the what? In the mutaakhirin. We're going to go into the last one, which is al-mustalahatu fi tarjih. When they want to strengthen between themselves opinions and views, how do they do that? And what are the terms that they use? They use the word al-adhhar. Al-adhhar. What does al-adhhar mean? Al-adhhar and mashhur and as-sahih and asah. All of that means the strongest opinion. What about when they say al-mashhur? They mean this is the famous view. But when they say al-mashhur, you always need to remember there is a view which is out there which is strange, is ghareeb. Are you with me, brothers? What about when they say as-sahih? As-sahih means the strongest opinion. It's the same as al-adhar, but the difference is as-sahih, that means there's a weak opinion also out there, but it's weak. And we will conclude there, inshaAllah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.